because a lot of people use that word lightly. Mm-hmm. Bullying is the constant taunting of an individual.
Absolutely.
The constant belittling and making that person feel uncomfortable and constantly coming after that person over and over and over again. That's what bullying is.
And it's also cyber trolling.
Trolling online, trying to
pull you in to cause type of altercations with people with the purpose in mind.
And with the cyberbullying is at another level. They have laws against cyberbullying, especially in the school system. Mm-hmm. In particular, I have suspended individuals for more than 90 days on cyberbullying. Do you hear me? Because you have individuals who commit suicide on cyberbullying.
I want to stop real quick because I do want to move from this and get to the things. And I do want to say publicly. So Sam Rivers is trying to call, and not because it's him. I said we're not accepting no calls right now. I want the candidates to get a chance to talk, and then we'll open the lines up later. So it's not ignoring him. He has made other accusations that people can read on Facebook, because let me just follow the Facebook page. You can see the whole thing. I don't have to read them. And if Omar wants to address them on social media or not, he can. So I just want to acknowledge that, you know, Mr. Rivers did try to call in, and we had already made the statement. We're not taking any calls right now. So that's it. So I want to move past this. I think you've addressed it, and I wanted to move past it. And I wanted to, you know, the point of this is, and also there was another comment that said it was a conflict of interest for Brenda to be on the show. I asked Brenda to be on the show because she was a former school board trustee. That was my decision. And she can ask some trustee questions. I mean, she did the job. I don't care who she's supporting or not supporting.
I want to
address. See, we keep things real, and I don't want to not. I don't want to not be real. You know what I'm saying? Absolutely. And I don't want it to be like you can see the comments and then you don't hear them. I just wanted to address certain things. You know, so we're going to move on. And I'm going to give these three individuals a chance to introduce themselves.
I'd like to say, though, I would like to have whoever the commentator was to please elaborate further.
No.
Yes, on what the conflict of interest. A conflict of interest is based on substance. You can't just assert it. There has to be a way in which Brenda's presence here is somehow or the other will influence or color her ability to make a decision. And
comment,
since it was made, we should hear it in its entirety.
The comment was written, and then we'll move forward. Thank you. It is also a conflict of interest for Brenda Crump to host the show where she is supporting the trio of crooks. And then the second comment was Brenda
but
is
that's
in
a,
the
that's but personal.
I know
personal.
Brenda is in the pocket of the preacher, so that
it's personal, man.
Well, listen.
Thought.
That's why
somebody
I kept
opinion.
It. I know that's why
but he's
I'm
just
keeping
sharing it, which is
right,
good.
Right. So I'm reading it.
At least wanted to know what was alleged to be the conflict.
Okay, well now we have that out the way. So again,
but this is the rhetoric that destroys our community, AJ. You know, and this is what needs to stop. You know, I don't consider myself to be a politician. I'm someone that loves my community. I'm someone that builds my community. Right. And this type of constant barrage of negativity is what's destroying Mount Vernon. Mount Vernon is a beautiful place. It's a great place.
You keep leaning out the shot. You can look up.
Mount Vernon is a great place. And if we don't learn how to work throughout differences in a constructive way and build upon our differences and recognize that, guess what? We're always going to be in different spaces from time to time. But to continuously... To turn politics and the conversation around politics and try to spin it in a personal format, to me, is disrespectful and it destroys your community. And if you're going to call yourself or anyone's going to call themselves community activists or people who are involved in building a community, and that's what they should do. They should build it, not tear it down.
Okay. Kenyatta Thomas. Hi, Bob.
Hey, what's up, Yatta? How are you, Yatta?
So now... We before I get the two yellow talk, you're the new guy on the block. So there are if I understand there are three seats up. One person is not rerunning. Who's the person?
Charmaine Farron. Her job responsibility, she has a very ginormous job.
Okay.
And she felt that she would not be able to continue to serve.
Okay.
But She has she's done a great job, especially with audit. And okay. one of the reasons why Omar and I felt that Ed would be, I'm giving you an introduction, would be a great would be a great person to fill Charmaine's shoes, so to speak, is because he has a background in economics from Yale.
Okay.
And he understands finance, and he loves, he's self-proclaimed budget lover. So we're going to need to fill that slot. We need people who can read spreadsheets and understand budgets. So
sure. There's something else that I want to bring up, though, and you were talking about it earlier. The mass incarceration issue?
Yes, yes.
Have you all heard of the Central Park Five?
Yes. Sure.
He's on the show.
We have
one of my best friends.
Yeah, we have him on the show.
Okay. I grew up with those guys.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So I'm from Harlem, New York. We grew up in the same housing project. And when that incident happened and changed my life, we were around the same age. They were teenagers. I was a teenager. Mm-hmm. And from when that happened, we all knew growing up there that they were completely innocent. We all knew that from day one.
Right.
But ultimately, they got railroaded by a bunch of folk, including Donald Trump. I remember yesterday, back in the 80s.
He was calling for the death penalty.
Exactly.
Yes.
I've spent my whole professional career, you know, fighting for brown and black people of color, really from that incident.
Okay.
So being a trustee member really is an extension of the work that I've done for almost 20 years. But here in Mount Vernon, you know, education is everything. And I keep saying that, but it really is true. So for those folk, obviously, that have kids that are in the system, they want the school system to be better. But even if you don't have kids in the system, the negative reputation we have in Mount Vernon in a large part comes from our educational system. So it's crucial that people that care jump in and try to fix what's happening here. And I'm very grateful to be running with Omar and Darcy, given the work that they've done over the past 3 years. And so really it's just fighting with them, or fighting on their side, that I should say, to then allow them to keep doing the work that they've done for the past 3 years. So that's why I'm running.
That's when he came through the show.
Good, yeah.
Yeah, his mother's been on the show a few times as well.
Yeah. I think Cynthia had him over at the Church of the Ascension about a
Yes.
When you were doing something with mass incarceration.
Yes.
I remember that, absolutely.
Yeah. And she came up for... She came up for
Raynette Turner for me. She came up for Sister Salam is the bomb.
Yeah. So and she's a fight. I have to give her a lot of credit, and I know this goes off to get back on track,
but
you know, and I say the same thing about Kenneth Chamberlain. When a loved one is done wrong, and I would love to say that I would be a stand up. And do as well as do the work that they do. But when your father is killed by the police department, mm-hmm. you know what I'm saying? When they come for a call for his medical alert bracelet going off, and they mm-hmm. beanbag him, zap him, and then shoot him, and then, you know, and then call him a nigger, excuse me, and then mm-hmm. the Janet DeFiore says that was just a term to distract him while they opened the door, that it wasn't a hate crime. And the same thing when she was here, she was like, when your son is incarcerated, it's like, he said, it's like the system's kidnapped her son for them years. You understand what I'm saying? And to hear her tell that story, like, and that now to be so efficient in moving, not for the fight, her son's out now, but to continue to fight for others that are wrongfully incarcerated and take up that mantle, and Kenneth Chamberlain to continue to fight with the Westchester Coalition of Police Reform for anybody's situation. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
I have to give, like, you got to understand when you hear that, it's not just because it was their kid or their father. Like, everybody, that's not, everybody's not built like that. And I would love to believe, and I hope I never have to find out, that I am built like that. But, I mean, Kenneth Chamberlain could be one of them F the police type of situations, mm-hmm. right. guys right now. And, you know what I'm saying? She could be on some old, you know, forget the system and not trusting the system and not having anything good to say, you know, on a negative thing. Which would be understandable. You know what I'm saying? A kid was, how many years was it? He was like 5 years, 6 years?
He was six.
He was six. Yusuf was in there for what, 6 years? Was it 6 years?
Yeah.
Like he literally went to the police, and again, not knowing that your rights, he heard they were looking for him. He went to the police station to clear his name and never came home. Like, I mean, basically that's what it was.
It happened to all those brothers. I mean, they were.
Because they caught one or two.
Ages,
they caught one or
five.
two. They caught one or two, but the other ones went in. Right. Him and his boy, they just went in to clear their name.
Right.
And never came home.
And they kept them under interrogation for 12, 13 hours. And sorry to get off of the track for a second, when you were talking about it, it kind of struck a chord in me because, again, I was a teenager when that happened.
Right.
And just to see how they got railroaded devastated us.
Right, but it goes hand in hand with that's education. Understand? Mm-hmm. It goes hand in hand with education because the thing with so my student was Romali Graham. And so the thing with individuals don't understand the most unique thing in regards to the Graham family is that when Romali Graham was shot by NYPD, the next day, the fathers from the school where we taught at, they came to help Frank because we had created in the school a culture of family. And although he had already graduated from the school many years, that culture, that love, that bond between the dads that we had created continued on. So when NYPD came to the house, they were met with the 100 black and Latino retired police officers who were friends with Frank as fathers at the school. And so it goes hand in hand where education, the education haven, the look at what education is and why isn't education working in black neighborhoods? It's because the culture, the character of it is minus the heart and the soul, right? And so when Frank called up, what's his last name? I can't remember his name. Berkeley. When Frank called up Chuck Berkeley is a retired officer. And he came in and he was like, you're not giving the police this, you're not giving them that, you're not doing this, you're not doing that. Do not have anybody speak to them unless they're a teacher, et cetera and so forth. He guided them. Understand, and that's because there was love in that school that I was in.
I want to because of time, I do want to get back to it. Mm-hmm. But my question for you, okay? So, I'll address y'all too in a minute. with all that's going on in Mount Vernon, the public school system, the pros, the cons, the graduation rate, a lot of the complaints that are going on, why would you be a good candidate? To be a school board trustee, what makes you want to be a school, and what do you think, if elected, you will bring to the board?
Sure. There's the upcoming, not bond resolution, but the execution of the bond resolution, that I'm sure everyone here knows about, that Darcy and Omar and some of the other trustee members got passed through a lot of hard work, $108 million bond resolution. There's also a restructuring of the school system that's going to happen over the next couple of years. I have a master's in urban planning, and I'm also an adjunct professor at Columbia now. Helping out on making that spend with the bond resolution as efficient as possible is crucial, right? Because if it's not done correctly, it'll be a decade before the citizens allow the school system to raise those types of funds and spend it on the school system for a second time. Also, in terms of the restructuring, you know, helping these guys guide that through to then make sure that it happens as successfully as possible. Because if it doesn't happen successfully, then we're all going to be laughingstocks. And one thing that I am is that I'm a fighter, and so that I'm ready to roll up my sleeves and work with them as hard as I can to make sure that over the next 3 years that we execute on that plan that they've come up with as flawlessly as possible.
I have a question. Mm-hmm. Since you do have a background in finance, mm-hmm. one of the concerns that I had when the commissioner visited last year with...
Superintendent.
I'm sorry, the superintendent, thank you. Mm-hmm. Visited last year, I think Brenda was here in the studio as well, was whether or not there were adequate financial controls that have been instituted in order to ensure mm-hmm. that we don't have a repeat of the kind of mismanagement of funds that marked the last bond. AJ and I were on the avenue, and some, you know, several current Board of Education staff members suggested to us that a lot of the money had been misappropriated.
Right.
And while I commend the superintendent for spearheading the effort to raise resources to do some much-needed infrastructure improvement, I wasn't fully, and this is only a mild critique, I wasn't fully satisfied with the answer that he gave with respect to the financial control. So that's what, can you?
So the misappropriated, with like
No, I'm not saying with this bond. Now,
no, in previous, what happened? Someone told us to watch.
I can address
they that. Told us specifically to watch what y'all are doing.
Absolutely.
And they hope that things are handled right this time.
Yes.
But in previous bonds, there was millions of dollars that just disappeared. People don't know where it went, who spent where it went, where it was misappropriated, and it was they were. While they were wishing this could go good, they were encouraging us, please keep an eye on what they're doing over there.
Well, as being part of the audit committee, I would say that that's somewhat aloof, right? I wouldn't say that there's millions of dollars that's just aloof, right? There is money that was spent that maybe wasn't spent in the best way that it should have been spent. Sometimes we consider that as mismanagement, right? So when you have buildings that you feel could have been built in a better, in a more structural way, right? When you build a school building that doesn't have an auditorium, right? And those are things that they consider as far as mismanagement. But as far as just money disappearing, the auditors have confirmed that all the money is accounted for, right? Outside of that, moving forward, because I wasn't a part of that, so I can't speak to it. I could just speak to that we did do an audit of portions of that bond, and what came back to us was that everything was accounted for and that all the books evened out.
I just want to be clear. I wasn't insinuating that the current bond.
But moving forward, for this particular bond, what we've done is some of the challenges that they have from the previous bond. What we noticed because we looked at it and we went back and said, we don't want to make those same mistakes.
Right.
We want to show the community at large that we're going to be more physically responsible with what they put in our kit, right? So what we did was, the first thing we did was we hired a superintendent, business superintendent, right? Because we didn't have one in the beginning of the school year. So we hired a business superintendent. That's our first level, right? The second thing we did was we hired an architect, an in-house architect, someone that works directly for Mount Vernon City School District, right? That's another layer of oversight. Then we also have our district architect that we hired from outside. That's another level of oversight. Then we also have our construction management firm, which is another level of oversight, who all of the contractors report to. They report to the construction management. So in previous bonds, they had two or three construction management teams that quit, disappeared in the middle of the project, which caused a crazy paperwork trail that it was very hard to patch together and put together for a number of different reasons. And now we have this continuity that's been going forward over these past couple of years of ensuring that we have the right people in place. We're not switching in and out so that now the trail can be tracked from the very beginning, from the genesis, if I would say, all the way to the exodus. So that's why it's also important that we ask that we keep this continuity with the school board trustees that are currently in place, and add Ed Poteat with his experience in construction and building and finance, so that now as we move through this process, guess what? You have the same trustees in the seat all the way through the end of this bond. You have the same administration in the seat, because also through that time, no, I wouldn't say that, that you also have the same administration moving forward. I got to make sure I'm on the radio. There's people taping right now, you know, and so, and also moving forward to the end, that we have the same administration in place. That means the same team that started it, hopefully will finish it, and that now all the answers, all the questions at the end, which we hope and our expectation is that we would get thumbs ups and applaud, that we gave the community exactly what we told them they would get, and that all the accountability is there.
Now I want to go backwards again. I wanted to give you a chance to address your letter that you released today, and we will have that team on next week, so I'm sure that they'll, you know, have something to say about it. So I'm giving you a chance to, why did you write that letter? Why did you feel the need to write that out to the people today, and what was that about?
Well, one thing that Mrs. Crump taught me when we overlapped on the board was that you need to know your policy. That when you become a trustee of a school district, and I had no background in this, I was mentoring students in the high school, but I had no background in education law. And so it's really important when you take the oath of office that you understand what the code of conduct is for school board trustees. So when I saw advertisements that said, specifically stated that the other slate, I won't mention names, are endorsed by school president Leslie Zamore and the majority of the school board trustees. That gave me pause. That gave our superintendent pause. And looking up school law 1534, it states that no one, in other words, no school board member acting in their capacity as a school board member may claim to be speaking on behalf of the school board and must avoid giving that impression that they are doing so. Additionally,
it's your contention that in the school board president endorsing the slate that in fact that
yes, he did, and at the last board at the April 4th board meeting, and there is video up on the website, you can see it. Mr. Zamora says he didn't know that, he was unaware that there was a law. And he said he would not.
That's not for me, is it?
Wait. It was not. He would not do it again.
And just for the record, he contacted me immediately and asked, because I rewrote the article, which was based on the press release, to change the language that he announced in his personal capacity. He is endorsing, not as school board. I'm just giving him his. Whether he knew it or not, you know, he did call. I don't know what point he called, but he did call me.
He called after he was reminded.
He went and asked us to change the language.
Well, that's the right thing to do. But the fact of the matter is, we were talking before about bullying. We were talking about misinformation, and we were talking about dividing the city. We have a highly functional school board that has been going along. We've agreed on just about everything. If you check the record, you will see many of the votes are unanimous. Because we're following the 2020 vision that we crafted that is embraced by Dr. Hamilton and his top-notch staff. So, and the fundamentals of that are the curriculum for the children. We have a faulty product in Mount Vernon. We have had. So the idea is we are a large corporation. Our business is educating children, helping them find pathways to career or college or whatever it is they want to do to be successful citizens in the world, and we weren't doing a good job of it. That's what the 2020 vision is all about, is providing multiple pathways for success. Absolutely. For our youth in Mount Vernon. Now, I would like to say that it's been interesting to me that when you have, there's an expression, why would you change horses in the middle of the race? That's an interesting question, because we crafted the bond, we went out and sold the bond door to door, and we have been implementing the bond. But be that as it may, one of the reasons I sent this letter is this is out there in the community, and the community sees something, and there's no retraction. No one's saying, well, wait a minute. So people think, well, this, maybe the school board did endorse a certain slate. And the fact of the matter is they did not. There was no resolution passed to do so, and it would be against state law, and we could lose funding for doing so because it violates the state, New York State school board law. So. That's why I wrote the letter. I was trying to set the record straight for the public. I've also done the same thing with a letter to the public and to community members who have received comments about my tenure on the board. And I've said, I just want to set the record straight. I would never go in for the kind of bullying and demeaning comments that are being made out there, but I feel my record should stand for itself, and I just wanted to set the record straight. And it's hard to get that information out. But that's why I go door to door. And I meet with real people and I ask them what they think and what they know and tell them what I'm all about.
Many of our listeners, viewers, haven't read the letter to the editor, although we certainly encourage them to. Can you? So you're alluding to misrepresentations of your record that they're not familiar with. You want to say anything more about how your record was misrepresented?
I don't know if I want to go there, but I will say that it's been said that I added no value. I was apparently given a grade of an F. And I would ask everyone who has a question, and as was Omar, as was Charmaine, and I would ask everyone, if you really want to know about the service we've done for the board, you should pick up the phone and call Dr. Hamilton. you should pick up the phone and call anybody at the Board of Education, and they will tell you. Because when you are an effective board member and you are doing your job, you are supposed to be setting policy and staying in the background and letting the administration, to whom we pay very good salaries, competitive salaries, we got the best because we want Mount Vernon to be the best. You stand back and let them do their work. You do not get involved in the day-to-day. That is not our job. So it's also been said that all I do is book fairs. I mean, I've been involved in fundraising for the district because the superintendent has said my literacy challenge is early literacy is the most important initiative in this town, so young people can read by third grade. That's our goal. That's part of our 2020 vision, our priority. And so when he asked me to go out and help him with his reading challenge, which he does every year, where students read books and then there's a drawing for them to win bicycles, I partnered with Barnes & Noble, did a fundraiser and raised $10,000 to buy nooks for these readers, which will be given out on June 8th at the high school field. So when the superintendent asked me to do something to use my background as a CEO and a marketing expert, I say, yes, how may I help you? How may I serve you? But I would never insinuate myself into his business because he's the educator and I'm the business person. The other thing I'd like to say about this ticket, this team, is that we're all business people. And so since a lot of what our primary job as trustees is to manage the money, oversight. And with a $240 million budget, you need to have trustees who can read a spreadsheet, who understand what a P&L is, who understand what forward vision is.
So what is a P&L?
A profit and loss statement. Okay. Now we have that.
Just so the listeners be like, I don't know what that is.
But how to build a budget. How to build a budget. You have to have the non-negotiables for the students first. What are non-negotiables, right? Decent bathrooms, excellent teachers, curriculum that's fair and even and lives up to the state standards in all the schools in Mount Vernon, north and south side. Those are non-negotiables. So the kind of budgets that we've been putting together have done extensive focus on professional development of our teachers. We've dehired a bunch of teachers. We have a couple hundred new teachers because we realized that we weren't, you know, teaching the way we needed to teach these young people. And we're moving towards digital learning. So it's very, very important to not just say, okay, we've got this budget this year and that's fine. We've got to be looking 3 years out, because there's a very good chance that the crazy people in Washington are going to cut our federal funding. Federal funding gets cut, then we have to go to the state and make our case there. But we want to be prepared and fiscally conservative so that in the event that that happens, that the National Endowment for the Arts gets cut, which funds 80 of our positions, or if other federal funding gets cut, then that we have the capacity within our budget to maintain the programs that we've begun, like the vocational, like the autism program, like the enhanced life skills program, and like the advanced programs, and like the performing arts programs. So I think it's very important to have school board members, to your point, AJ, about it's not a popularity contest. It's about rolling up your sleeves and understanding the business of education. And I take that very seriously.
And now I want to, I was reminded of several comments and conversations I had with the former mayor, Ernie Davis, and he always broke down that 66 or however many cents off every dollar goes to the school. 75 cents of every dollar goes to the school, and he was like, you know, and a lot of people blame this mayor for not getting a lot of things done, and Ernie always said, Mayor Davis always said that, you know, with only a quarter to every dollar coming to the city for the city to use, maybe we need to look into how much money is actually going into the school system and address that issue, as opposed to, you know, expecting the city to get things done with money they don't have. Mm-hmm. So I've never had a chance to talk to any of you about that.
I actually brought that up at the board meeting the other day, and it's not even really in our purview really to discuss, but as a community, it's something that should be done at the legislation level, and convincing the legislator that they need to change the funding formula and how education is formed. It's paid for, and quite frankly, through the leveling of taxes, is not the most efficient way, especially for homes and communities. I mean, excuse me, for homes in Mount Vernon, where there's a large percentage of free and reduced lunch that's being offered. So what does that mean? Free and reduced lunch. That means we have a high level of poverty mm-hmm. in Mount Vernon. And when it's being levied through taxes in order to pay for education, it makes it difficult for communities like Mount Vernon. So there's been plenty of conversation from my understanding with the regents up in Albany, and maybe even Ms. Crump even knows some more about it in more detail. But I think that it should be changed. And actually, the superintendent had brought to our attention about a pilot program in California where the state has picked up, they have stopped levying taxes on homes, and the state has picked up the tab and is paying for public education, which in my opinion is the correct way, because at some point you get to a point where the community can no longer sustain themselves to continue to pay these type of taxes as they continue to rise. So that's one way as a community to go to our legislator, to go to our assemblyman and have this conversation and say, we need to discuss how education is funded in this country, in this state per se, if we're gonna keep it local in this state, and talk about changing that allocation from levying of taxes to completely funded by New York State.
But there's also one other point, that I wanna make being the new guy here. And what you said, AJ, is important. The school board has a higher budget than the budget for the city of Mount Vernon. Yet, when people come out to vote, that they're focused on voting for city council members and then voting for their mayor, I would please beg everyone, hopefully that you vote for us, because I think we're the best candidates, but you gotta vote Tuesday, May 16th, given that one point, which is that the school system in Mount Vernon actually has a larger budget than City Hall. And that's crucial. And so why vote for City Hall and not vote and not take the vote for the school trustees as serious or even more seriously?
Add one thing, because we can't talk about the budget and talk about this without putting in perspective that since our time over this 3 years as trustees, myself as the budget committee chair and Darcy as the co-chair, that we haven't increased taxes in 3 years, which is unheard of in the state of New York. No school district from the list that we can see up today, even up to this particular budget this year, has not levied a percentage to their constituents in over 3 years. And the reason why we came in and we did that is because we recognize that Mount Vernon is overtaxed. Mm-hmm. And we haven't provided the product that Darcy just talked about in a way that's acceptable. So we wanted to stop levying those taxes, show the community that we can be more fiscally responsible with what you've already given us by continuing to create programs, continue to build within the spectrum of what you gave us, and grow. And that's unheard of. And we recognize that. And that's why we haven't raised the taxes from a school district's perspective in 3 years.
Real quick. Three people have asked me who's here. So briefly again, 30 seconds, just say your names.
Sure. My name is Ed Poteat. I'm running to be a trustee member on the school board.
My name is Darcy Miller. I am an incumbent. I've served on the school board for 3 years, and I'm running for re-election.
And Omar McDowell, who's currently a school board trustee and running for re-election as well.
And for those, we will take calls like in about 20 minutes. I wanted to get as much done as possible because I know where calls can take us, so, and then we won't get to issues. So, but I do want to, you know, open the lines up though too. So, there's a lot of people feel, and Mayor Davis again, you know, one of the things he spoke on is that much money going to the school, and maybe he's speaking when he was in office, I don't know about the last year, but the school going down each year, the graduation rate going down each year. You're giving all this money to the school and the school is doing worse. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, that's a problem. I know we got a new superintendent who appears, and I'm careful with my words, we've had him on the show, he appears to be doing the right thing. He appears to be someone who's going to work. I mean, time will tell overall, you know what I'm saying? But I mean, my interactions with him, he appears to be a good addition.
It's not an appearance. It's in the data. It shows that the trajectory of the Mount Vernon City School District has changed over these past 3 years. The data is there. Mm-hmm. You talk about graduation rates earlier, right? Mm-hmm. Thornton High School at 92%. Mount Vernon High School is at 72%. No quote, it might be 71.
Is that this year?
That's this year. That's
okay. Actually, Thornton's at 95%.
Because last year, what was it, like 47% or
60 something?
For the high school?
The high school was at 64.
Here's the thing. Change is hard. And boy, do we know that in Mount Vernon. Change is very hard. This school district did not get into this state in 3 years or 5 years or even 10 years. It got in this state over a long period of time. Why did it get into this state? One of the main reasons is because we churned superintendents. We had no continuity. We had no long-term plan. And we really, really didn't have someone steering the ship and saying, this is the direction we're going. And we didn't have a board that supported the direction. This 2020 vision that we have now is supported, was supported when we created it in 2015, supported by 100% of the board. 100% of the board supported the priorities. So the reason we got into this mess is because there was no one minding the mint, as they say. There was no continuity of personnel, and we had a semi, you know, a board that was not functioning as a team. That has all changed, and you are now seeing the results. One of the reasons we re-upped Dr. Hamilton's contract and some other senior cabinet members' contracts is we want them to stay through 2020 because this is the commitment we made to the community. And the reason the money wasn't well spent in the past has nothing to do with what's going on today. And but change that is like boom doesn't last. You have to, incremental change means you stay the course. You say, this is a good thing. The people of Mount Vernon spoke and overwhelmingly approved the $109 million bond. We have to stay the course and deliver to them what we promised them.
Okay. One other thing is, I'm happy if that is the new graduation rate. I'm definitely happy about that. Because a lot of people were saying, I'm seeing the outside of the buildings look a lot nicer. Mm-hmm. I'm seeing.
It's not the outside; it's the inside.
Yeah, but I'm just saying, like, yeah. People, absolutely. When they drive, you don't see the inside when you drive by. You don't see.
Well,
the
you
inside.
Don't see the teaching when you drive
yeah,
by.
Yeah. So, but that's what they wanted to know: what's being done for the curriculum, for the courses? What's being done for the students? What's being done for the learning? Like, what is you know? Okay, the buildings are nicer, and that's important because the buildings. Some of the buildings do look a lot nicer, absolutely. And the curb appeal. Like, if you're shopping for a neighborhood to live in, the first thing you're going to see is the outside of the building. You understand what I'm saying? You're not going to know nothing else. So if there's no curb appeal, you'd be like, you
well,
just keep going.
They're going to tell you quick. As soon as you're going door to door, somebody's going to tell you quick, don't send your kids there, which is something that needs to change in Mount Vernon.
But, you know, we're never going to have people buy homes, and our property values are never going to increase if we don't offer an excellent, safe, and equitable educational environment.
Absolutely.
And that's what Dr. Hamilton's doing. We have a curriculum catalog for the first time. We have teachers who are feeling so much pressure by the instructional rounds that our administration does. They go in and watch them and without notice and see what they're doing. We are putting the heat on. As I mentioned before, we have a couple of hundred new teachers who are willing to use smart boards, who really understand. I'm not throwing anybody under the bus, any of the teachers in the past, but you know, we have a whole new level of accountability now. The schools are much calmer. You see less craziness in the hallways. I've noticed that because I do.
I can say that Damon Jones and I just spoke at Career Day.
Yeah, I was there as well.
Yeah, and you know, we got to talk. And I'm proud to announce one of the students. You know, we should give back. So, you know, I was going to write something, and I said, well, I told to Peggy Williams. I talked to Peggy. I was like, can you give me a student who's, you know, wants to be a journalist or a writer or something, and let them cover this event. From their perspective, you know what I'm saying? And then you have all these photographers, people taking pictures, give me the pictures and I can credit all of them in the thing. And then one or two girls in the classes we spoke actually want to be journalists and ask questions. And they have all emailed me, whether for internship or about writing articles or something or, you know, stuff like that. So I mean, you know, I mean, we all got to give back. And I just want to say, like, I was glad they asked me. And then when I saw that they needed, some other people had got canceled, I suggested Damon too. And then they had Damon, and we both went, we spoke in one class together and we spoke in class separate. But it was a great experience. And I can just say that, you know, I've seen the hallways from Mount Vernon, good and bad, for over the years when I was there other times. And, you know, it was a more, and then the kids were like, oh, thank you. And they were, you know, very helpful to show me where I was supposed to go or, you know, just,
it has its time, right? Can we be real? I mean, we have our issues. I'm not sitting here and telling you that everything is great and perfect in Mount Vernon. There's a lot of things that we need to deal with and we need to dive into in Mount Vernon. But as a community, we have to stop being dogmatic about our own community mm-hmm. and start looking at the glasses half full. Mm-hmm. Let's start looking at the positive that is taking place in Mount Vernon mm-hmm. and build upon that, right? Mm-hmm. So you asked that initial question in this part of the segment where you said, well, what's taking place inside of the building? I think me and Darcy have said some of it already, but does it calculate in the people's mind of what's being done when we talk about the dehiring of teachers, right? In order for a child to be successful in a classroom, they have to have the right teacher in front of them as a very strong part of the component of learning, right? They have to have a strong teacher. So if we have a teacher in a classroom that is, don't have the capacity, don't have the ability to manage a classroom in Mount Vernon, maybe they even have the skill set in another community, but maybe they just can't hack it in Mount Vernon because there's some real issues, right? We have some real social emotional issues in Mount Vernon that has nothing to do with the school district. It has to do with the environment that they're in. And some of it is at no fault of their own, right? They're victims of their community, they're victims of their environment, and it translates sometimes into the school building, right? So we have to make sure that we have the right teachers in place, teachers that have the skill set that we need to have class management, teachers that have the skill set as far as being fresh and vigorous and ready and haven't been here for 40 years and maybe they're tired. They've been in the grind for a long time. So we've been dehiring teachers, right? We've been also making sure that, guess what? We've been very stringent on
professional development.
No, not professional development, on tenure. You know, not just giving tenure out just because you've been here, but making sure that you earn tenure. I think tenure is very important and something special that you earn as a teacher, right? No other place in society do you pretty much get a guaranteed job, right? But in education. So we have to make sure if we're going to offer tenure.
I would not agree with, there are plenty of other professions that have mm-hmm. similar protections, and we need only look at firemen and police officers.
Civil service, yeah.
Yeah. But
to the tenure point,
because I want to mm-hmm. address this.
To the tenure point, we've been making sure that if we offer tenure, when I say we, I mean administration, because remember, we don't manage the district. We just oversee the district, and we made to the point of the district. We want to make sure that if you're going to offer tenure, that this teacher is worthy of getting this type of, as you know, the two protection and job. And as I know, too, that I believe that it's almost giving you a job for life, right? So we got to make sure that we have the right teachers in place. The second thing we've been doing, as Darcy was about to know, too, was professional development, making sure that we continuously train our teachers year over year. It's like having a doctor that never goes for training. I don't think none of us wants that doctor, right? We want a doctor that's up to date on the skill set and the new issues, the new things that's going on in medicine, right? So that when we visit them, that we know we have a top-notch doctor. It's the same thing in the classroom. So we've been focusing on not just the beautification, which I believe is important, because as our children go past Pelham, as they go past New Rochelle,
right, right.
they see those buildings, right? And they may not be able to articulate it like us, but they saying, wow, why do our buildings look like crap? Why do our buildings look like this? Why
especially
do my buildings
especially Pelham. When you go Pelham, is
why does my building stink? Absolutely.
I mean,
yeah.
So, it's right there. It's like.
Absolutely. So it can change and inspire a kid when they see the building change. Because we see it. If you see it, they see it. Right. So that makes them feel proud. That brings back school pride. I'm proud about my school. When we did the gym over, my daughter's on a volleyball team. They were so proud of themselves to have the visiting team come in. Because they were so embarrassed when the visiting team come in to see the bathrooms looking the way they did. Like, man, that's like somebody go to your house and your house is a wreck.
Right?
That's embarrassing. So that brings back school pride. Now if a child is proud about their school, now they can come to school somewhat more ready and engaged and ready to learn, right? Then the other thing we did was Darcy talked about was school choice, right? Giving kids the choice, right, to choose from. So when you looked at, and this concept for myself really stemmed for the basketball team. When you looked at the basketball team, I'll make this short. I know you got a lot of things to cover. When you looked at the basketball team, how many kids do you see getting in trouble off the basketball team? Little to none.
Or the track team.
Little to none. Why? Because they're passionate about that particular area,
right.
and they've connected that to education, mm-hmm. understanding that the two go hand in hand. Right. So by us creating the three schools of excellence, the Magnet Arts program, the STEM program to come, and revitalizing our CTE program, which is career and technical programs. Now we're able to tap into the child's passion. We give them choice. Here, are you interested in the arts? Then let's get you in this program. Are you into in science, technology, engineering? Then you go to this program. Are you interested in auto mechanics or nursing or culinary arts? Then you go in this program. And just like the basketball team or just like the track team, now we connect that to education and we can continue to raise levels. Now you said you have your experts here. If I'm wrong, you guys tell me if I'm wrong, but when you tap into that child's passion, no, I'm just saying. I know we have a principal here.
I'm sorry.
I want to give you all, before I open the calls up and a matter of time, I want to give each of you all at least like 3 minutes, if we can keep it like around 3 minutes. Why you? Why should I vote for you? Why, you know, as opposed to anybody else? What do you, you know, anything you want to say about yourself, anything? And y'all can start whenever, where you want to go.
I'll let you take it.
Well, what would I say? Why me? I believe in Mount Vernon. First and foremost, you got to have people at the table that believe in all Mount Vernon. I'm not North Side. I'm not South Side. I'm not East Side. I'm not West Side. I'm not Black. I'm not white. I believe in Mount Vernon. And if we give the children an opportunity and the tools they need to succeed, they will succeed. We just need the people at the table that understand, and I believe I understand. I believe that I believe in Mount Vernon and that I want to see them drive forward. Am I the most articulate person? Do I have all the degrees that some people have? Not at all. But as you noted too earlier when you talked about Brother Crump, I didn't just start this when I decided to run. I was supporting the district. I was involved prior to me even becoming a board trustee. I was on committees. I was PTA president. I was visible in the schools. So I didn't just start this because of the title. I'm in this because my children go to the school district, so I have a living vested interest from a personal perspective.
You're saying no sound, they saying no sound, my man.
And I believe also in Mount Vernon. I can
just make sure okay. You make sure there's sound.
No problem. And I also believe in Mount Vernon, and the work that we've done already, I believe, should speak for itself. And how we dealt with business at the table already. And all you have to do, as Darcy said earlier, is look at the record, look at how we voted, look at how we've already changed Mount Vernon in these 3 years, and I would ask you to support my candidacy as school board trustee, as well as Darcy Miller in Ed Poteat.
Why am I running again? I'm running for re-election because after 37 years as a businesswoman, when I retired, I found my true passion, and I don't get paid a penny for it. Mm-hmm. And that is working with young people. I started a nonprofit in 2011 with some of my neighbors. We're all Mount Vernonites, called Mount Vernon Star Scholars. And through that program, I've had the opportunity, as I mentioned earlier, to personally get to know many of the students in our community and to understand the challenges they have. And it really was astonishing to me when I saw these students that we were mentoring, and we were sending them to Harvard and Yale and NYU and Columbia, and no one knew that. And I said, this is just the tip of the iceberg here. So when I was approached by Mr. Zamor to run for school board 3 years ago, I said, well, you know, I've been making a difference one child at a time. Maybe I can make a bigger difference. I'm still mentoring, but maybe I can make a bigger difference by working on policy and accountability, because I saw things in the schools, just as you said, AJ, that were absolutely unacceptable. I had the young women I mentored say they couldn't go to the bathroom all day. So I'm running again because I made a commitment to Dr. Hamilton that I would see the 2020 vision through. I'm retired. I have no skin in the game. I never want to run for political office. Never. And I'm working to engage more members of the community who are retired and who don't have children in the district to get involved, to come to the musical performances, because I think that's how we build community. And the article that was in the Journal News this morning that talked about broken Mount Vernon and Mount Vernon in ruins, my feeling is, and I said this in church this morning, my feeling is that You're only broken if your spirit's broken. And the spirit is broken when people aren't getting the right information and when people lose hope. And I still have a lot of spirit and I have a lot of hope. And I am totally committed to this district. So that's why I'm running again. And I am very proud to be running with Omar McDowell and Ed Poteat. And I just encourage whatever you decide to vote on May 16th, because we really need to bring it, because we're going to have to go to the governor when we lose federal funding and say, you got to step it up to fund for Mount Vernon. Thank you.
Why am I running? I'm not going to steal some thunder from Omar, and Omar says this often, which is education really is about equity, right? That you can't always put a child in the right place. They have to make decisions on their own. But you want to be able to give them the right opportunities. Education has been a lifesaver for me. You know, as I mentioned earlier, that I grew up with the guys from the Central Park Five. We were very similar. The only difference is that I was able to get a great education, which is why I stand here now with the life that I have. It's criminal if we don't give that to our kids here in Mount Vernon. And so as a trustee member, hopefully, that I'll be able to allow them to have some of the opportunities, or really all the opportunities that I've had through education. Because education, as we all know, is really the great equalizer. So if we care about our kids. Our platform is children first. And you do put children first by making sure that their education is top notch. So that's why that I'm running with Darcy and Omar.
Is everybody from Mount Vernon? You said you're from Harlem?
I'm from Harlem, but I've been in Lower Westchester for 15 years.
I'm originally a Jersey girl.
Okay.
And I'm originally from the South Bronx. I've been in Mount Vernon.
You know the reason I ask, you know the reason I ask, and Damon gets this a lot because he was from Greenberg. You know what I'm saying? But he's been here 10 years. You know, he's been very vocal and very, very out there. You know, his wife works with the police department and everything. And they always be like, oh, he's not even from Mount Vernon. He's running on his, he's not from Mount Vernon. You know, I was born here. I left, came back a few times. But I mean, oh, he's not. I didn't spend my 51 years here.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying. Oh, he's not from Mount Vernon. He's not real Mount Vernon. Yeah. Like, how are these people outside of here going to tell us what to do with Mount Vernon?
Right.
So you know, just
and you know, just like, you know, on that point, you know. So I ran for school board a couple of years back, and what I got was the fact that my children were not attending a Mount Vernon public school.
Right.
And I got flack for that, but. You know, my explanation was that my sons asked me, I put them in public school. I was studying to become an administrator. Mm-hmm. And I felt as though that it was kind of odd that my children were in parochial school and I'm running to be an administrator. And 10 times out of 10, I would be an administrator in a public school. So what I did was I took my sons out of Our Lady of Victory and I put them in the public school in Mount Vernon, right? And my son was bullied to another level of being uncomfortable. Mm-hmm. To the point where he looked at me and he said,
why are you doing this to me?
Yeah. On the strength.
What's the problem, Mom? What you doing?
On the strength. And so I was given the charge. You know, Mr. Jones was livid. And he said, I don't care what school you find for them and how much it costs. But they can't stay in there. And they both ended up graduating from Graham Elementary School. The teachers at Graham Elementary School are absolutely fabulous. They are awesome. It was unfortunate that they were in classes with individuals who were not nice. And I took them out and I put them in Mount St. Michael Academy. And when I was running for school board, every single time, there was I forgot what the dude name was, but he was punching me every single time. He would get on there and was like, your children don't even go to them, you know? And so my thing was that no child should have to go through that.
Malcolm Clark private, wanted to agree with you. He said, like, going from private to public school is a rough situation.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so no child should have to go through that. No child should have to attend any school on whatever level it is and be taunted and bullied to the point where they beg their parent to please take me out and put me somewhere else. Now, we were fortunate because we can do that.
Right. And may I interject here? Let me step in here, because that's a great segue in, Cynthia, for me, because as a parent, my husband and I have 7 children, 5 daughters and 2 sons. All of them have gone through the Mount Vernon school system. We have our 2 youngest, which are the twins right now, and they're 12th grade. And I do that because, you know, we're about ending this line here of children and being in the school system and so forth, and kind of circle back around to just the two of us, like when we got married. You know, they are,
No more kids?
Stop, AJ. So as I was saying, we're down to the last 2, the twins, and they're seniors. So all of us have gone through the school system. And I, as a parent, I have had the opportunity and the choice to be able to send some of my children to private school and have it paid for. But because of the makeup of my home, with children being in special education and different levels of special education and in general education, there's a good percentage of the schools that don't, they're handpicked and chary of the children. So children sometimes at the different special education levels cannot get into the private school. So nonetheless, we made a choice in our household, and I respect everybody's choice, but we made a choice to stay and fight and not flight. And my fight have always been for all the children in the system, not just for mine. Many of the fights that I've fought were for children
situation that did not impact my children directly. So what I say for those parents who are not afforded the opportunity because they cannot afford it or whatever the reasons are, they're here in the system. And so they need somebody to fight for them, somebody like those who are running for school board, and not necessarily these three. And I'm not even going to address the issue because I think that people who know that I'm fair, I'm just, and if anybody's hard on this school system, it is I. And as AJ have said, prior to running, my advocacy is broader than the city of Mount Vernon. It's city, it's county, it's state, it's national. There are videos on YouTube and stuff that you can pull up in reference to my advocacy for families and children and foster care, adoption, child care, etc.
Fighting for the library.
Library, whatever. The fight is there for children and families and for our community. And I think I know it's important to say that my advocacy is not just about children and families. Children are first for me. That's not, I have nothing to do with their slogan. My stuff is out there. Children are first priority for me. Then it's parents, it's families, it's staff and district. And I separate staff and district because sometimes our administrators, our teachers, our custodial, our secretary, whomever you are, there are no big I's and little U with me. They need help. They need advocacy. Even our central office administrator, the superintendent, whomever it is, I keep it real and I keep it straight. I call you up and I let you know where it is, and then I do this one-on-one. Can we sit down and reason together? And if we can't reason together, then you will see me at the podium. So this is for the record for those who don't know me. When you see me at the podium talking publicly, I've already done the one-on-one behind closed doors. And when I see an injustice to children and families, I'm going to step up.
Real quick,
I just want to talk about a school that's here in Mount Vernon, that because I don't know if anyone knows in regards to special ed. So
the
state,
hold.
One of the things that the state started doing is that they started they want students who have special needs to go back to their zone schools. So just to give you an example, you may have a child who's autistic, mm-hmm. and they went to a specific school for autism. And what the state has started doing was they started saying that these children are segregated, these students are not with their peers, mm-hmm. and they need to go back to their zone school. But what happens with that is that the zone school is never, and I'm gonna say it one more time, the zone school is never prepared mm-hmm. for the autism or the special needs that these students bring, mm-hmm. right? And so what happens is that these students come in to their zone school, and the zone school is told, yeah, well, you gotta teach them. And so there's a school in Mount Vernon, it's the Rebecca Turner School. That happened in the Rebecca Turner School.
For the old Longfellow, for those who...
Right. And so there's a cohort in there. There's a student. There's a higher number of students who are autistic in that school, and have special needs in that school. But I know that the staff have not received the type of professional development. Being that you guys talked about professional mm-hmm. development, they have not received the type of professional development that they should have received, or that they can receive, and that they need to receive. In addition, when you bring in something like that, every and anyone who are teaching students like this are to be paid on a different scale, right? And so I am charging you guys to look into that, to go to the Rebecca Turner School and to check out what they have, and to make sure that what they have is up to par and something that you would send your own child to. Mm-hmm. See, one of my best friends, her son is autistic, but he is not there, right? And the reason why he's not there is because they don't have mm-hmm. what Yorktown has. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. So he's in Yorktown, right? So like Brenda said, you can either fight or flight. Some people gonna take the flight because some individuals mm-hmm. cannot constantly fight. Guess what? I'm about to fight up out of here, and we're gonna make sure that my mm-hmm. son get what they gotta get. So he is not attending the Rebecca Turner School because they don't have mm-hmm. what what this little man needs.
Absolutely.
And so, right. And so that right there needs to be addressed.
And then once again, let me jump in, because as I'm going to jump in at these points where I can speak factually, I can speak as a person who's been there, done that. As I said, with the different levels of educational needs for my children, there came a point where one of my children was sent out of district to school, went to Mount Kisco, Carafin School, and that was via the school district. So there are avenues within the district, but it's about informing, enlightening, educating, and empowering our community, empowering our parents, and giving them that knowledge, because your rights is only as good as your knowledge of them. So informing them of their rights, that there are mechanisms and means and ways at which the school district can educate the children outside of the district. So all of our children are, yes, because we're different. They're different. And so the educational needs are not going to be met within the school district. I don't care what school district you have. The best of the best school district have children with different types of special educational needs and levels that are outside of their district.
Absolutely.
So that's not just a Mount Vernon thing where children go outside of the district or need to go. I've had, you know, mine to go. I've fought for others to go. And then within our district, all of our buildings, the 16 school buildings, do not have the same educational programs. That's not humanly possible for us to have the same identical programs in the school. So the programs are set up according to the needs of the children, and then they're put in different schools. Now, I do have a challenge, as I'm saying that, I do have a challenge with what needs to be monitored by our trustees is the overpopulation of certain buildings or particular buildings or one building versus others.
That's right.
And especially when that line is drawn, because anybody who's going to say that there is no north side and south side, you're not being honest.
That's right.
You're not being honest at what exists. However, the challenges that come with being north side, south side, so to speak, it is what it is, but it doesn't have to be.
That's
and
right.
That's where the trustees, and not only the trustees, but the parents, not only the parents who have children in the educational system, but also our community members. No one escapes. Everybody have a certain amount of weight on their shoulder to make this educational system work.
That's right.
That our children, not just ours personally, but our children in our community can get the best education possible.
I want to get real quick. We're going to go to a first call. But I wanted to, we got a lot of people in the check-in, Nazarene Duncan, Anthony Old School Mitchell, Lorraine Lopez, Malcolm Clark, Don Figger, a friend of the show, Kenneth Plummer,
Kevin Bunch,
who says he's listening and supports.
Kenyatta Thomas.
Well, someone wanted to hear Solomon. That part. You just left someone very disappointed.
Solomon Peterson. I think there's a few others, but those are the main ones that I saw. And I just wanted to at least get that. Now, we are going to get to this first call. Caller, please state your name and your purpose for calling, and if you have a question for the candidates.
Hey, AJ, Samuel Rivers, how are you, Cynthia and Robert, doing today?
Okay.
Sam, how are you today, brother?
I'm all right. Well, I came in, I listened to this show, and a lot of stuff you guys said is rhetoric. First of all, about cyberbullying. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on it. We're just going to let the public know. I've never been sued for anything for slander or defamation. Now we come to a point in age when you tell the truth that it's cyberbullying. So tell that to the Journal News, because half of that stuff you saw in the newspaper came from stuff that I put out that they investigated. And it made it to the front page of the newspaper. So we got to clear up, because I believe this whole campaign of Children's First is fraudulent you're running. First, we'll start with Darcy. Darcy, you never voted for Kenneth Hamilton. You voted for Richard Tomko, and I'll post a record on
Sam,
Mount Vernon.
Do you have Sam, do you have a question? Because we need a question.
I'll get to the question. So, secondly, we're going to get to Mr. McDowell. Second thing is, how can we trust someone who drives around in a luxury car, collects food stamps, is on Section 8, as someone the best one to make tax policy for our district? Just doesn't make sense. It's like putting a bum in the White House and saying, run the country.
There is a bum in the White House right now. But go on.
Well, I mean, we can deal with that later. I voted for that bum. So, you know, that's another issue.
Yeah, I got you.
Secondly, you just go after the school board president, Leslie, for saying you did something inappropriate on a flyer. But I was assaulted. Your running mate was arrested. He's currently in court facing criminal charges. And we have no public apology. the message you sent to the children is that we handle our disputes with violence. So, I mean, clearly we don't have a level-headed thinking trustee, because if I would have defended myself with deadly force, I would have been in the right on my own personal property. So we do not have a level-headed. You talked about level-headedness and professionalism. Stop trying to ram these candidates down the community's throat. That's why I got involved 12 years ago and been very successful in stopping people like you from getting elected. And I tell you now, to May 15th, all my might, every strength in my body will be to stop you guys from getting elected. You guys have a good evening. God bless you.
God bless you, Sam Rivers.
But wait a second, what was the question?
Hold on, don't worry about that.
It was more in the way of a comment.
So like,
anybody who had their name mentioned that wants to address anything that was said?
They don't have any comment.
Wait. Anybody who wants to address anything that was said, you know.
Speak now or forever hold your
peace. This is the rhetoric that we talk about all the time. The Donald Trump-like tactics, being that they supported Donald Trump, they use those same tactics in spewing rhetoric and lies and false truths about myself and Darcy, and this is what needs to stop. We need to build a better Mount Vernon. Let's discuss the issues and let's start with the rhetoric.
Because I have to be clear that in politics there is a distinction that must be made. Oh, we got a fire here, y'all. Come on, come on, y'all.